नाउ लाइव।
आई कैन फील इट मैन।
Okay, a very warm good evening to everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Chandana Kaur. I'm assistant professor in Patel Hotel and Tourism Business School, Ansal University, one of the leading universities in Delhi NCR. Today we are starting with our hospitality and tourism interface workshop series, which is focused on evolving traveler sentiments during this COVID era. Our first topic of the series is instilling confidence to travelers and customers. Safety is in top of mind for travelers as they look beyond the current shelter-in-place pandemic towards a recovery period when they can resume traveling. What else are they looking for beyond safety? What sources do they trust for information? What reassurances do they need when they travel? To understand the topic on a broad spectrum, we have with us today Karan Thabra. I take this opportunity to introduce Mr. Karan. Mr. Karan Thabra has a diversified experience of over 15 years in hospitality and travel industry. He is an alumnus of IHM Bhopal, management trainee from Oberoi Center of Learning and Development, graduate in commerce and master's in digital marketing. He is currently associated as marketing advisor Asia Market, PT Asia Koleski Travel Bali Indonesia, which is bootstrap Indian and Asian markets for destination management company, clocking annual revenues of over $1.4 million, being net profitable on a consistent basis. Served more than 20,000 plus customers, 300 plus travel agents across Pan India. He was previously associated with groups like the Oberoi Rajvilas, the Park New Delhi, the Ramayana Resort Spa Bali Indonesia, and ICS Travel Group. He is also a certified hospitality administrator from American Hotel and Lodging Association. He has worked in the capacity of executive housekeeper, executive assistant manager, and resident manager for scale hotel brands. He has also been a part of trade show exposures. To name a few, Arabian Travel, which happened in Dubai in 2012, 13, and 15, ITB Asia in Singapore, 2015, PATA Macau, 2010, in New Delhi, 2011, and MATA in Kuala Lumpur, 2014. Over to you, Mr. Karan, give us a few insights on the topic and let us know how we can instill that confidence in our travelers and customers.
Thank you. A warm welcome to everybody. Today is a special day, as we know that today is around. It's a day for commitment, for security, for all the brothers from the sisters. So I think it's a very good day to start what we are talking here about, building confidence in the present and the future traveler in the travel industry. Indeed, it is a very unprecedented times. I mean, nobody even imagined that the whole world will be on a standstill and lockdowns will happen all over the world. There'll be all countries having travel ban on each other and the whole world will just stop for a few months. Nobody even imagined. But this, if we see this, that this pandemic has given us a very, very important aspect, that whether any industry you're working in, public health comes as a priority, which I feel that travel industry, not only travel industry, but many industries were not really focusing that we are working for people and people's health is the most important. So I feel to see this pandemic in a very positive way, it has brought out that public health is the sole important for each and every individual. Rest all can take, aside. In fact, on a different note, on the positive side of the pandemic is that a lot of desires our industry had, for example, we can take an example of an airline industry where they desired that the face detection is a very good method for checking in people, because a face is a very unique feature in each individual. But I think that this pandemic has really accelerated the growth, accelerated the application of what was desired for our industry in terms of air travel or in terms of other parts of the travel industry. In a way, this pandemic has accelerated us. We are in 2020, but we are applying what we desired to apply in 2025. So in fact, we have escalated 5 years in our industry, whether it be a hotel industry or whether it be airlines or travel or tourism, everything. And we are a very, very important, and students are a very, very important part of this industry. And we have to be really, really very confident that we will bounce back very soon and very strong. We are the ambassadors, we are the representative of this industry. This industry is formed by us, you and me and all the students and professionals working. So we first of all have to be very confident in our systems, in our hard work, in our the whole setup as a whole, so that we can instill confidence in others. So any negativity on our part will reflect in our consumers, in our guests, in our travelers. So it's just like, you know, we are just like doctors having a performing a surgery. So if doctor is not confident, I'm sure the surgery chances are of survival are very less. So we are the doctors, and we really, really have to instill confidence, and so we have to be confident ourselves first, and then only we can instill confidence in the traveler.
You're on mute, Chandrana. You're on mute.
Sorry. I have a question for you, Mr. Karan. It comes to my mind, yes. Whenever a natural or a man-made disaster or a calamity happens, first industry to get a brunt is travel and tourism. You take the example of any kind of terrorist attack or now this pandemic, and we are the last one to bounce back. So your comments on this, please.
We are working we have to agree that our industry is the most sensitive industry, because it just doesn't only involve hotel industry, it involves airlines, it involves travel agencies, it involves because we are the industry who are dealing with 100% human. We are dealing with human emotions, we are dealing with human health, we are dealing with human lifestyle and necessities and desires. So we are the most sensitive because the fact is that we are dealing with the most sensitive aspect of this planet, which is the human. So yes, our industry is sensitive, but we don't have to forget the fact that we are the most, tourism industry, travel industry is the most resilient industry in the world. Let's take an example. When you said that 9/11 happened, the Mumbai bomb blast happened in Mumbai. So our industry was the most hit industry. But now you see within a few years time, that where we were and where we've bounced back. So we had to adjust few things which we thought are not very important at that point of time. So we accelerated ourselves in terms of guest safety and security, and we bounced back very soon. So that is why, you know, I mean, especially for the students, you know, we are the most resilient people in various industries. So that is why you see hotel management graduates are in demand for many other subsidiary industries, many other parallel industries. For example, you can say airlines and customer services and call centers and, you know, banking services, insurance services. They prefer to take hotel management people because they are the most resilient people. So they can face any kind of an adverse situation. So that is, it's a two sides of the coin, you know, being a sensitive industry, but we are the most resilient. Well, I come from Bali, Indonesia, where it's a very small island, but it has really, really faced many challenges for the past two decades. I mean, nobody can forget 2002 bombings happened in Bali. So Bali, the occupancy from 98% within 3 days came to 0%. So the island really, really had to suffer a lot. But within 2 to 3 months, the island started bouncing back to normal, and for now Bali's TripAdvisor's number one destination in the world for traveling. So I come from a destination where we face these kind of challenges very often. So 2017 we had a Mount Agung problem, the Mount Agung erupted. So there was a problem with the travel flights, but the island really, really bounced. So there are various examples we can quote here wherein the industry has suffered and has shown that it is sensitive, but it is really, really bounced back very.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I have one more question which comes to my mind now. Right now, travelers are not traveling. Okay, either they are traveling because of compulsion, but not by choice. So, what are travel agents are doing in order? Your travel groups are doing in order to cultivate that sense of you know what you what in travel groups are doing in order to do something for the travelers in order that they travel again. What kind of
I got your question. It's like you know, when we work too hard, we need a break. And when we need a break, we do a couple of things at our home. You know, we clean our things, and you know the almirah, which is really really in a shabby state, we do that. So we, what I personally feel that this is a break time for the industry. So we should make the best out of whatever break we are getting. So in terms of travel agencies and travel groups, what personally I am doing is in my company is, I'm utilizing this time in a very, very positive and a very productive way. First of all, we should remember that we are in business and engagement is a very, very important aspect of modern business. So we are constantly keeping engaged with our clients on a day-to-day basis. Number two, we are doing things which we desired, as I said, that we would do in future. So this is accelerated that, for example, we are making some good itineraries, we are making some good products for clients which are more nature friendly, which are more adventurous, which are more exciting. And you know, a lot of hotels in Bali which were coming up in future have accelerated their construction to be quick on the on board. We are also doing few things like we are doing a virtual videos for our clients, which we would present to our clients to choose which destination they want to go or which part of the tour they want to do and which tours they want to do. So they have free time and you know they can go through and do a detailed survey and then you know decide, and when the travel opens they will travel back. In fact, we are indulging in a lot of schemes as well wherein we are it's something like, you know, you book now and travel later. So okay, this gives a lot of confidence in travel that you know we have. This is not only selling, it is just, you know, more importantly, it is giving confidence to the travel that the travel industry will be back soon, and you will be able to travel in future. So this is not the end of the world. The tourism industry is not going to die. It's just that it's a phase of life, and the hotels which are shut now will eventually open sooner or later. So it's just that it's a phase of life. We are just hoping that it passes off soon. Every good thing comes to an end, and every bad thing has to come to an end. So and at the end, we are gearing up for a stronger comeback.
Okay. Thank you, Karan. You have really given you, Karan, that yes, we need to remain positive. Tourism is not going anywhere. Travel is not going anywhere. People are going to spend money and travel and definitely. Now talking about little bit about health and safety. You know, we have spoken about tourism and travel. About health and safety, what kind of protocol a traveler should take moving forward? What kind of general health and safety protocols which are being made to make the traveler feel that yes, in order is how I'm going to go forward for my travel? What are the protocols we have made up?
Yeah, you know what we call is a new normal. I think is the normal for future. So there are certain things even when we have vaccine, we really have to instill in our mind. Yeah, there are certain learnings from this pandemic we have to carry, because we don't know the future. You know, we have COVID-19, we have some virus which is 2025. So it is a good preparation, to be honest, for each industry, including the travel industry. And some of these protocols should be a basic normal, not the new normal.
Okay.
It has to be normal. So things like, you know, in current situations like. Of course, social distancing, I would not call it social distancing, I would call it physical distancing, because the virus is quite communicable. So social distancing, wearing masks which are mandatory for airports, keeping your hands sanitized and keeping basic hygiene is very, very important for the travelers. And in fact, a lot of airports have done a tremendous amount of work in terms of putting stickers and, you know, keeping sanitization handy for their clients. And in fact, the travelers also have to understand that, you know, due to this, they have to reach airport a little earlier. so that they don't end up crowding the spaces, and the security checks happen very smoothly. So these kind of things you have to really, really keep in mind. But I think technology in this terms is helping us a lot. I mean, currently you check in Dubai, the only thing you need is your hand phone to check in. You know, and the only thing you are touching right now is your hand phone to check into a flight. So I think there are certain major good developments in terms of protocols which will help the industry in future. And it might feel like a new normal for us, but that will be very soon a normal procedure for us. So technology, in fact, is escalating the fight with the pandemic for the travel and tourism, especially with the airlines industry, wherein, you know, Emirates was thinking to do that 4 or 5 years back, that they will pick up the luggage from the home and, you know, deliver at home. So Emirates is one of the pioneer airlines in terms of innovations and in terms of technology. So I feel that these are the basic things the traveler has to keep in mind.
Okay, Karan, thank you. One more thing, you have just said something about airline industry. Now this question comes to my mind, that people are afraid of taking long haul flights now, you know, because of the fear of transmission. You know, people don't want to travel and take flights which are very, very long. A shorter distance might do, but not longer ones. So how can we tackle this issue in the travel industry? You know, because every destination is not going to will be very nearer. It will be, you know, some of the destinations which are far, and you have to take that flights which are longer. So in order to, you know, to do that, what kind of, you know, how can we tackle that problem in travel industry?
You know what, I feel that people are scared of airlines because this virus came from some other countries and across the country. Airlines is not responsible for bringing this virus. People are being responsible for bringing this virus. So airlines, we can't blame the airlines, you know, to spread the virus between the people. It's just that, yes, because of the cross-border travel, it spread very fast. So what I feel is, I mean, you go to data and you see that WHO, even the European Aviation Security Agencies have displayed that, you know, cabin air changes in every 3 minutes to the total different air, and that removes even the smallest particle of size of a coronavirus, if you are talking about getting, you know, a virus during the flight. So it removes the smallest particle. They have HEPA filters in the airlines. So I feel that there is virtually it is eliminating any kind of transmitting any communicable disease within the flight. So we can't blame that, you know, airlines. If we go to, and of course, we have to keep certain protocols in mind. We have to keep hygiene measures in place, and we have to be careful in such times. But I feel that, I personally also feel that air travel is the most safest travel till now in the world.
Yes, you exactly said that. Yes, the airlines are doing a lot of things in order to, you know, control this. And yes, people have to fly. People will do it. Travel is going to happen. Okay, what process do you foresee for the travel industry to follow to come back, you know, pre-COVID?
We have to be very practical in terms of assessing how the travel industry will bounce back. Let's be very practical in that the fear of virus is more deadly than the virus. People have recognized this sooner or later. So in fact, I feel that the travel at the domestic level will bounce back sooner than international travel. Because travelers are still a bit scared to travel internationally, not because of the fact that they are scared of traveling in an airlines. They are scared that during this kind of situations, if they are in their own country, they are more safer because they know people, they know the system, you know, things like that. Vis-a-vis, they are traveling to a different country itself, which is a foreign country for them, and they have no contacts and, you know, they don't know the systems and everything. So I feel that domestic level, it has to start, which we see that in the couple of my friends who are doing domestic travel, they are seeing that there are weekend travels happening starting July. So people want to travel, and they are booking hotels for a weekend for two nights, three nights in nearby destinations, you know, like Lonavala and Mahabaleshwar. So these destinations have started picked up. So this is a very positive sign that people still want to travel, and the travel industry will come back soon. So first of all, on a domestic level, what I feel is that sooner or later, in fact, very soon, these interstate quarantine requirements and, you know, PCR testing and everything has to really dilute, and which will be what I feel is which will start maybe by September. So the sense of normalcy has to come within the country first, and then when the domestic tourism picks up, and then we can talk about international tourism picking up, which I feel is later this year or early next year. So by December, January, we will be able to have a better situation control, and travelers will have more confidence in traveling. So in fact, if we see that people have started telling that India's recovery will be a V-shaped recovery, so V-shaped recovery is not a bad thing. So the economy will come back soon, and of course people will travel. We are a social animal.
Yes.
We have few questions for the panelists also.
Yes, please, sir.
Yes. Kulwan sir, had a question.
Yes, Kulwan sir, please. Yes, Kulwan sir, please.
My feel is that the travel agencies all put together, no matter what they do, how much money or whatever they put into, still they cannot without the help of the government. Now, government also has to see that the travel agents, poor people, have been out of job for such a long time. They have not earned anything, nothing they have done. So what is the travel trade looking or expecting from the government to do? This is something which I'd like to know, because then if the government is working with you shoulder to shoulder, then things can be resolved. Maybe you know better about it.
No, what being a part of the tourism industry, I feel is that the government will support us. But maybe it's not the right time for the support, because the government at their level have their own priorities to bring back the economy. Because travel, to be honest, with all these confusions happening and, you know, lockdowns opening up and again, you know, locking up, the government, what we heard is we've been doing a lot of meetings with the government, a lot of tourism people, big shots are having meetings with the government and trying to find some solution for the industry. And last week we got a news that the government has some plan for the hotel industry as well as the travel industry, which they will roll out very, very soon. So I feel this is the right time from the government point of view that we should come into picture and the government should start supporting us.
Working on mute?
Now when those travelers start traveling again, they will obviously expect the hotels for a much better rate, or, you know, they won't be able to prepare the rack rate or whatever. So the hotels might do business, but then they'll have to start from, let's say, previous year's rates or whatever, and pick up business at whatever rate that it comes. Is that quite true? That the hotels will have to, for some time, you know, put a blind eye toward the ARR or something like that, you know, to grab business, whatever comes or whatever happens. Is that what the that's a big challenge for the hotels? What are they going to do?
Mr. Singh, I think you're not wrong in saying that the hotels have to close their eyes initially, because the hotels would be, I mean, they're the most hit part of the industry, apart from the airlines industry. I think that during the recovery stage, they would have to close their eyes for some time to get the confidence back of the customers, and profit making for initial 6 months would not be a motive. Surviving would be a motive, to be honest. And within 6 months, I think the things should improve once the travel opens. So, and hotel industry is a very flexible industry, and they would go through it very soon. So,
we can say that
yes, there would be challenges for the hotels in terms of generating.
So this means there is no any kind of budgeting or whatever, because everything's gone haywire.
Well, Mr. Singh, budgeting always considers all the other situations to be normal. So unprecedented times need unprecedented solutions. So I feel that budgeting would not help. More revenue would help hotels to build up, to come back to normal soon.
Yeah.
For the next 6 months, really have to work very hard, engage customers, and get the branding back, and get the confidence back of the customers, and overlook to the ARR and FR. So this has to be, there has to be done for some time, and this is the hard fact. We can't deny that.
Yeah, I guess in order to win the customer confidence, they will have more confidence in you because you are maintaining highest standards of hygiene and cleanliness and sanitation. I think that is what we have to sell rather than what our features or our suites or whatever, or our cuisine as such. Isn't that so?
I would agree, but to a certain extent, because some hotels I feel are portraying hotels as hospitals. And they're showing videos of people all over wearing masks. I mean, this would create confidence in terms of clients, but an excessive of it might give a very negative view of the whole situation, wherein the client is thinking that this is a more hospital than a hotel. So to a certain extent, to gain confidence, yes, these things are very, very important, but it should be done to an optimal level, not more than that.
Yes, any other panelists have any other
I have a question.
Anshu, that's Anshu.
Hey, Anshu, Karan, then me. Okay, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Karan, sir, myself, Anshu. I just wanted to ask one question. That in hotels, we always talk about wow factor and guest delight, and we sell it as a package altogether to a guest, just to impress the guest and make his or her stay comfortable in the hotel. What is tourism industry, tour operators, travel travel agents, what they are planning or they are doing right now, because they do not have much to do right now. Tourism industry is being adversely affected. So what do you think that what they should do or what they are doing actually in this time?
I discussed this with before as well, that we are utilizing this time in a very positive way. We are creating itineraries, we are creating different kinds of products, we are creating virtual tours for our clients, it's a very constant approach to keep the clients engaged and to keep the interest in travel, first of all, because right now the situation is that people are very scared of travel. So what personally I feel that the travel agencies and the tour operators should do is to keep the spirit of travel alive as it was ever, and use this time positively to create virtual tours, and there's so many innovative things you can do. A lot of travel agencies, including myself, they never believed that we should be online, and now we are working on a whole portal system wherein we'll feed in our tours and feed in our rates and everything to our agent partners. This is a very good time to think to escalate yourself from 2025 to 2020, so you can really jump five years.
Absolutely, sir.
Hi, sir. I have a question. Talking from the food and beverage perspective, what are we giving to the customers to regain the confidence? There's also meals that is being served on the airlines. So any concessions on the meals part or any of the F&B services that we give to the guest, or it's just that if the guest wants to shift from the single seat to a lounge area, or is it some kind of services that we are giving extra to the guest in this pandemic times when it reopens, or it will stick to the normal rates and policies that we have?
During this pandemic times, usage of public areas should be avoided, because there are a lot of people coming in a close contact and sitting together. So I feel that a lot of hotels have started doing that. Even if it's a business hotel with 500 rooms, they have started giving in-room dining for breakfast, so that the guest has a choice whether they want to go to the coffee shop and eat, or if they are not so confident of going to a public space, they can order the breakfast and enjoy in their own privacy. And similar with lunch and dinner. And a lot of hotels now, in fact, have been very innovative in terms of using open spaces instead of closed spaces. So I feel these are very good developments in terms of future for hotel industry, which are coming into realization now.
I have a question as well, more of a remark than if we, we all this time, a lot of people are saying the industry is suffering. They, we have lost employees, and but if you're saying hotels are serving breakfast, lunch, and dinner in a room, that must take a lot of people to be able to coordinate and do this. No,
I mean, compared to the occupancy is what they are having right now. They can afford to do that, because if it's a running full house, then it will be a challenge for the hotel to arrange that kind of stuff. With these kind of basic occupancies, they can still, they are doing all what the best they can do to regain the confidence of the clients that they're in a safe hands.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Hi, Karun. I'm trying to roll these conversations, and we have been having them for months together now. Do you think the customer or the guest now would be kind of, less godlike and less demanding on the hotel industry after this? Or how will their expectations from the hotel industry change, firstly? What will they expect now? And will less be more for them? And how, what will happen? Basically, what will be the paradigm shift in terms of customer expectations now that they travel, or now post-COVID, they would be enjoying the subtleties of our five-star properties?
Dr. Garima, I feel that what we are talking is just about 6 months to 8 months to 1 year's time. Of course, the priority of the clients would be in they would spend a lot of time in choosing the hotel for sure right now, because they need to make sure that they're in the safe hands, and they're staying in a very safe and clean and hygienic place. Yes, their demands might increase in terms of hygiene and safety standards, and how they are handling the clients and how they're sanitizing the place, because we are still in the middle of the pandemic, and people are still paranoid that's what happened in 9/11. What happened was every hotel had this big machines, scanning, and people were very, all these dogs sniffing, and people were very paranoid of the security, and all these government meetings happening. There were 5, 6, 7, 8 inspections happening, whether this is the place is safe or for the meetings or not. So I feel that initially it would be a concern for the travelers, and they would be more demanding. In fact, they would be more demanding. So more will be less for them, not less. Okay.
Any other questions we have?
Yeah, I've got a question in my mind. We were actually studying a topic today that was about disaster management, Karan. So now it is that we have had so many disasters happening over the time, some of the other problems coming up. Why is it that our industry does not make a contingency plan? Why don't we have something in place? We should actually be having something in mind. Like, I'll give a small example, like thing you were sharing, that the tourism agency right now are doing something or the other, like you were saying. My point is that why did they had to wait for the last moment when the staff was like that, we need to be paid the salary, we need the money right now. And then the tour operator said, okay, if I want to give the money, I have to give them some work. And that is when that kind of work came in, that you make tours, you streamline the work. Why is it that we don't have something in place right from the beginning?
Right from the beginning, you mean, Sunil, that right when the pandemic started?
Yes. Yes. We knew that something is going to go wrong because WHO announced long time back there's no cure. We should have planned something in advance.
Sunil, what I personally feel is that in such times, which nobody has faced, I mean, none of us have faced the pandemic before this, which was about 100 years back. So it was indeed an unprecedented times, and people, there was a lot of confusions and a lot of media involvement in that. So people were not sure that what is happening. You know, you can only make contingency plans when at least you are 50% sure that, you know, this would happen. And we never expected that this pandemic would stretch to almost 6 months to 8 months to might be in a year. So to be honest, I don't feel that that plan could have been made in such a short duration.
But when I see things, like I'll share a small example with you. Like we were able to experience something in France. It was like a virtual tour, the VR tour. That works out quite well. So if in case the regular tourism is not working, the places are closed down, people move towards that VR tour. Why can't we have something like that in place in India? Even though the ones who are making those tours in France were getting the software from India.
Right. See, on such a mass level, there is a lot of agencies to be involved, and the government has to support in that. So, well, in India also picked up, to be honest, but we are a little late, as you said, Sunil. But we are, to be honest, India tourism has never been a priority for anybody. In fact, Indian tourism gives about 9% of the GDP, which is a very, very big number. But I think that now the government has realized that it is a very important aspect for the economy, and that's why government is now started giving value, and we are hearing that the government is rolling few plans for our vendors. So it has to be done on a very synchronized way. I feel the Indian travel industry would be more synchronized after this pandemic, because we never had an opportunity where we needed, to be honest, each other for a common cause. So this might be a cause wherein hotel and travel industry within itself would be more integrated towards one main goal.
Yeah, anyone else from attendees, if you have any question, you can type it on the chat box and we can take this up. Karan, one positive question. We have spoken a lot about, you know, what we are doing, what we are not doing. Now, what do you see positive, anything positive happening, you see, for the tourism industry, which is going to happen after this, you know? Are there any positive trends that are going to happen?
I am sure there'll be a lot of positive developments. I call it 2020 a year of reformation. So, you know, whenever there's a reformation happens, there's some destruction happens before, and then only you can reform things. You know, you have to renovate your building, you have to really, you know, deconstruct the building, and then you can renovate it. So it's like a renovation process going on for the whole world, and our industry is a part of it. So as I said before also, which were, well, this industry will flourish for sure. Hotels will get back to occupancy for sure. We can take examples of Maldives, for example, wherein they opened their tourism from the 15th of July. And from the 15th of July to the 24th of July, the report shows that there were about 904 travelers coming to Maldives. So within a span of 6-7 days, there were about 900 travelers in the middle of pandemic traveling. So travelers' desire to travel is not dead. Travel industry is still alive. It's just that it's a break we are having. And once this break is over, we will get back to track soon. Hotels will get back to track soon. This is an opportunity, as I said, to renovate whatever renovation is needed, to clean for the hotels wherever the cleaning is needed. You know, whatever systems were not working, you can make a plan now. I feel, Chandna, that technology will play a lot more important role in our industry, vis-a-vis which we were dealing with till now. In fact, technology will help us to create better experiences for the guests. There would be certain aspects wherein we think that it might, you know, the human touch might go away, but at the end it will give the client more smooth, you know, for example, in a hotel, the stay would be much smoother and people will be more confident. So I think technology is the main keyword here, that we have to use technology now, which we were thinking, for example, you know, airlines doing baggage pickup from homes and, you know, checking into a bar with the QR code. This I just heard 3 years back, and I said, okay, we'll do it when the world will do it, you know. So now this is the time when the world is doing it and we have to follow it. So, and we'll see a lot of innovative changes happening in the hotels. And I read news all over that, you know, hotels are, the hotels which were in the middle of construction have stopped the construction, and you know, they're looking more efficient way of using open spaces and new concepts for checking, and you know, touchless checking and you know, minimum handling of guest luggage. So there'll be a lot of innovative designs and a lot of innovative technology, a lot of innovations happening in our industry once we come back. So in a way, it will have some positive effects as well. Of course, we can't ignore that we had a long stretch of no business, but at the end that this will give us a very positive which we never we thought we would do it in future, but it will become a necessity. So I think 2021 would be a year for us, that we've accelerated 5 years, not only 1 year. So there'll be a lot of innovation.
So a lot of activity from it, yes, this country is going to give us something. We are going to be more intelligent. We are going to develop a lot of because of this, which we were not doing. Correctly said, right. And about for our students, I would like to know what kind of career growth, you know, after this. Because right now, the students who are graduating or who are opting for this course, they are in, you know, a little bit dilemma that whether this industry, you know, what is going to happen and whether we should opt for it. Or what, you know, if they are going to graduate this year, what are the future career growth in them? So a little about in travel industry, how you see our students, you know, can have that kind of growth after this pandemic also?
That students, first of all, should not be disheartened. As I said before, this is a phase of life. It is not the end of life. Not only travel industry, a lot of other industries are going through it. I mean, be it automobile, be it, you know, chemical industry, or be it construction industry. So all industries are going through this troubled times, and we are a part of it. So they, first of all, they should not lose hope, because this is a very transitional phase for everybody. They should, in fact, whatever time they have after their graduation, should use themselves to, you know, develop their more skills and sharpen the skills they have. Take up a short course in the hospitality, which was not taught in the college. In fact, your college can, you know, for the students who are graduating, can introduce additional short-term courses of 3 months or 2 months, you know, so that they can sharpen the skills which they were not able to do. Do that, or you can do a personal one-to-one-on-one, you know, what do you call it? You can assess that, you know, this students need this sharpening of skills, and you know, you can add that course for 3 months or, you know, 4 months. So, and then, you know, they can, apart from sharpening your skills, you can, you know, of course, chefs, for example, working in cooking, then sharpen their culinary skills, you know, within the college, and college can give them, you know, additional. And then, you know, take time to groom yourself and be, you know, this is a time that you have to really make yourself fit for the industry, so that once we bounce back, you are in demand.
Thank you so much, Karan. Any other questions? Okay. If you have anything from the panelists or from the attendees? Okay, Karan, thank you so much. You have been a responsible are, you know, such a resource for us. You have answered every query and every doubt which we had regarding the travel industry. One thing which I want to ask you personally, why you shifted from hotels to travel? You were doing so well in hotels. You were a resident manager when you last I spoke to you. Why did you leave hotels and you travel? That is my personal question to you.
It's a personal question, but yeah, I would love to answer that. Chanda, what I feel was I got positions very, very soon in my life. So at the age of about 32, 33, I was handling 300 room property directly reporting to the owner. So although my position was an executive assistant manager, but I was handling on a wholesale basis. So I felt that at that age, I need more challenging. You know, you have that zeal in you, you have that enthusiasm in you. Right? You know, handling a hotel, I feel it's after 40, you become a GM is much more relaxed, you know, rather than you becoming a GM in 32, 33, you know, because you have so much to do, you know, it's so much of energy. So I felt that I want to do something more dynamic. So I said, okay, either I have to go into hotel sales, which we're downgrading myself because I've been a GM and I'm handling sales. So I said, okay, travel industry is a very close industry to hotel industry. Of course, I had no clue of when I joined this industry. I had no clue of this industry. I had zero, what do you call it? I started from the scratch, but I made it a point that I have jumped the industry and I have to make a name for myself. So yeah, so challenges and I felt that I need more. And this industry in fact, me being a hotelier has helped 50% in this industry, because once you come from out the hotel background, you have to deal with hotels on an everyday basis. So that I feel that in travel industry, any hotelier who jumps into a travel industry would be a more 50% more advantage than, you know, a person who's a fresher, because you know the basics. So once, you know, hotels come to me and we negotiate with the hotel, so I know what is the allocation of breakfast in a hotel, you know, what is the allocation of a high tea in a hotel. Yes. So, you know, so these benefits, so these kind of small things has helped me. And I'm quite satisfied with the I've had my share of hotel industry and my share of my toil and hard work and recognition in the industry. And I feel hotel industry really, really makes you a real good human being vis-a-vis other industry, because you have to deal with n number of things and you have to deal with different kind of people and different aspects of life and different aspects of human psychology, and you know, so it's quite a good industry, and I, it's not that I left hotel industry because I didn't like it. It's just that I wanted to do something more on an advanced level than just being a hotelier. So now I have a travel experience and I have a hotel experience. So
yes.
So it really gives a competitive edge.
When you're ready, you can join education.
Yes. That's true.
Okay, Karan, thank you so much for joining us, and you know, for the busy schedule, you have taken us time, and I just called you once and you agreed to do it. And I'm really thankful to you. It's our pleasure having you here. Garima ma'am, if you want to say something. I'm really thankful to you.
Thank you so much, Karan. I'm really grateful that you have been a part of this webinar and talked with us and given your insight. It's really a pleasure to connect with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you all the panelists, all the attendees who have joined our first series, first topic of the workshop, Hospitality and Tourism Interface. Stay tuned for our tomorrow session, which is with Mr. Sajid Nehru. On contactless, the new normal of the hotel industry. So thank you everyone. Thank you Mr. Karan Chhabra again for joining us today. Thank you all the panelists. Thank you Laura sir. Very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you.